Father, thank you for this. Even then, we ask you that you speak to us tonight. Open our spiritual eyes, our spiritual ears, our spiritual hearts, that we may receive and understand your word. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Even as the scripture says, the entrance of your word gives light, gives understanding unto the simple. We ask you, Lord, to shine your light of understanding into our hearts tonight. Let it give us understanding. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The scripture says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, that it is God who said, let there be light, has also shone into our hearts the light of the knowledge of the glory of God revealed in the face of Christ Jesus. That's very powerful. Amen?
Amen.
And so that's what we endeavor here today, or that's what we seek today, that the Lord may shine the light of the knowledge of the glory of God revealed in the face of Christ Jesus, that it may also transform us. Amen? Because if you go to verse 18, just prior to that chapter, chapter 3, verse 18, it says, and we beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another degree of glory, or from one level of glory to another level of glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord, or, and this is also by the Spirit of the Lord. What does your say?
Mine is New King James.
Uh-huh. Yes.
But we all, mm-hmm. with unveiled face, beholding yes. us in the mirror,
mm-hmm.
the glory of the Lord,
yes.
are being transformed into the same image from glory
yes.
to glory.
Hallelujah.
Just as by the Spirit of the Lord.
Just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. So that is why we are here, that the Lord may transform us. Amen.
Amen.
Into that image. Hallelujah. Into that image. So last time, when we had a very powerful discussion on this church of Sardis, and we continue to unearth and to learn new things, the Lord continues to teach us. We have initially said that each letter is an instruction to the church, yeah, and this instruction is coupled with the rebuke, the encouragement, and the promise, and the command to repent, yeah. And we understand that each letter, this is God's letter to the church. This is God speaking to the church and speaking his heart to the church. And we ask one question one day, is that if God was to write a letter to you, what do you think would be contained in that letter? Amen?
Mm-hmm.
What would be contained in that letter? If the Lord God Almighty is to write a letter to Christian. Now, and as you see, he writes the letter to each church here. Really, the time and the resource, the sheer time and resource he takes to write the letter, amen, speaks so much of the love of God for the church. Amen. And we also say that one time, that this letter, you see that when the Lord speaks to each and every one of these churches, now we are the church of Sardis, yeah? You see that the Lord is speaking to each church individually.
Yeah.
When he's speaking to Smyrna, he is not speaking to Smyrna in light of the church of Ephesus. He doesn't say, because Ephesus have done this, let's see how much you measure up compared to Ephesus. No. He does not use Ephesus as the measuring stick. He does not use Pamphylia or Pergamon, yeah, or Laodicea, or any other church, or Philadelphia, yeah, or Thyatira as the measuring standard for all the other churches. No, no. In fact, whenever he begins, he uses himself as the measuring line, the introduction. We said, when you look at the introduction, it already speaks the entire message to you. you can already tell from the beginning the introduction with which he introduces himself already speaks of the message and the instruction to this church. Amen. The introduction speaks of the message, the rebuke, and everything already that this church needs to be careful of. This church needs to observe. Amen. Hallelujah. So in that way, look, as he introduces himself, he said, he that has sharp eyes, or whatever, blazing eyes, he that has bronze feet, as he introduces himself that way, then he speaks the message and the rebuke, yeah? And in doing that, he is therefore using himself as the standard by which the church should measure up. Oh, that's powerful. Amen. Yeah, that's powerful. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's really powerful. Because he does not say, Thyatira is better than you. At least not here. Amen. Of course, somewhere, you know, when the Lord in the book of Matthew, he says, Sodom and Gomorrah, on the day of judgment, will be better off. But then he does not say Sodom and Gomorrah will be saved. And then Capernaum will go down. And so, no, he says, when Capernaum and Sodom and Gomorrah will end up on the judgment seat, Capernaum will be beaten with more lashes than Sodom and Gomorrah. Nevertheless, the standard is not Sodom and Gomorrah. Mm. Amen? Yeah. As here. So the standard is the Lord. Ah, I love this one. So thereby, thereby in doing that, in introducing in chapter 1, and then taking an element from chapter 1, from the revelation in chapter 1, and introducing himself to each church, thereby he is making himself as the standard by which the church should measure up. Hallelujah. So, the church of Sardis is dead. That has come out clearly. Amen? Mm-hmm. And we have seen that in our quest, we understood that the church in Sardis is dead because the Holy Spirit is not there. And we understood that the Holy Spirit, if the Holy Spirit is not there, then that means he was there at one point. By the way he speaks here. Amen? And so we also came to a point where we said, now, that they had put on this makeup to give a certain image. Amen? They put on a makeup to sustain a certain image that to the world it was working. When the people looked at them and said, ah, this one is a lively church. But heaven looks at it and declares boldly, dead church. They even have to break the news to the church in Smyrna. So last time then we said, we continued further. He says, wake, oh, sorry, I read again from verse 1. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. So that's a very sharp rebuke. Wake up, number 1. He says, wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Now, that's where we ended last time. He says, I have found your deeds unfinished. Now this is the second time he mentions the word deed, yeah? Because in verse 1 he says, I know your deeds. You are dead. Amen? Now here he says, I know your deeds. Yeah? He says, I have found your deeds unfinished. Now what does he mean, your deeds unfinished? Now if you have multiple translations, okay, if you look at different translations of the scriptures, some scriptures translate that word unfinished as, what does yours translate it as?
For I have not found your works perfect.
Perfect. Now that's very powerful. Amen? Mm-hmm. What does yours say? Verse 2. Read verse 2 there.
Revelation.
Yeah.
Oh,
Revelation chapter 3. Uh-huh. Is here. Verse 2. Read verse 2.
Be watchful,
Continue.
And strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found the way perfect.
Perfect. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So this is the King James. Yes, that's New King James. Powerful. Yes. NIV says unfinished. King James said perfect. Not perfect, yeah? And then the New American Standard Bible says incomplete, but it says, for I have not found your deeds completed in the sight of my God. Hallelujah. It says, so here you use the word complete. Amen? While in the Amplified, it says, rouse yourself and keep awake and strengthen and invigorate what remains and is on the point of dying. For I have found a thing, for I have not found a thing that you have done, any work of yours, meeting the requirements of my God, or perfect in your sight. So now, we see something that's very serious. And you know, if let me slow down. When you look at the word perfect, and the general understanding of the word perfect in our generation, and perhaps throughout the ages, is the word perfect, we look at it in a light wherein it scares us. The word perfect scares us, yeah? And that's why we don't really like to stick around perfectionists sometimes, because when you are close to a perfectionist, they're always, you know, they say, why are you speaking like that? Or whatever. Or do it this way. Amen. But my focus is not the perfectionist. But the word perfect scares us. If you ask someone, are you perfect? Yeah? Or if you ask someone perfect, the quick and first response is, no. Amen. And rightfully so. Hallelujah. Rightfully so. No one is perfect, no? But now, that's why, I rewind again. What did I say?
No one's
perfect. The word perfect, what? Scares us. What else did I say?
If you ask someone
you're perfect, no, no? Mm-hmm. And if someone claims to be perfect, the first question that comes is, are you saying you have never ever done anything wrong in your life? Amen. if someone claims to be perfect, people, they go back to the day of your birth. Hallelujah. And say, let us look at your complete life from beginning up to today. Are you saying you have never told a lie? Are you saying you have never even done something, you know, that you know was not right? Hallelujah. But now, in this situation we find ourselves, in this sea of imperfect human being, yeah? So it is on this background, or should I say, of imperfect human beings that this scripture comes. Wait, did I say that right? Wait. Go to Romans chapter 3. Go to Romans chapter 3. And verse 23, yeah? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if I've read that well. Or if I've said that well. Romans agrees and indeed puts a stamp that nobody is perfect. That's just as before the Lord, yeah? Before Jehovah, the creator of heaven and earth, when you bring mankind before him, the cry of Isaiah is the cry of all people. He said, woe unto me, wait, before I go to Isaiah. wait. Romans chapter what? 3. Yes? Mm-hmm. I'm going somewhere. Romans chapter 3 says, what does it say?
For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
Aha. For all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. Meaning, for all are imperfect. To begin with. Amen. Hallelujah. When it says, on your marks, get ready, go. On that word, go. Everyone is imperfect. Everyone has sinned. Like this. Bold line like this. Hallelujah. But now, this scripture must be understood in context. Yeah? There's a huge discussion here that I didn't delve into in chapter 3. Hallelujah. But now, I said, if we are all to appear before the Lord, go to Isaiah chapter 6. If any one of us, just as a person, you are to appear before the Lord like this, the cry of Isaiah becomes your cry. It says in verse 5, woe unto me, or woe is me. Amplified says, for I am undone, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. We will all call upon ourselves this curse, as it were, as Isaiah called upon himself. Say, woe unto me. But you must understand that now. Isaiah was a priest. But he said, woe unto me, for I'm a man of unclean lips. All have sinned. But now that begs a question. If all have sinned, then why would the Lord God Almighty come to the church of Smyrna, Sardis, and say, hey Sardis, you are imperfect, and that's a problem. Now, why would the Lord come to Sardis
and require perfection?
Aha, powerful. Why would he come? Of the things that he raises as an issue that he must address with respect to the church of Sardis, begins with death in the camp, and then he moves on. Now, of course, there was a lot that was encapsulated there that we have unpacked, yeah? He says, now, you, not only are you dead, but you see, your state is such that your work is unfinished. Your work is imperfect. That's a problem. He's saying, Sardis, you cannot walk boldly with your imperfect works before the Lord. It's almost, it's a rebuke. This is a rebuke. But now, how can it be a rebuke? Because people today, they like to take pride in their imperfection. Yeah? They like to take pride. He says, are you holy? No. I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. Are you judging me? Don't judge me. No one is perfect. You know? We take pride. People take pride in their sins. Don't judge me. Only God can judge me. No one is righteous. Don't judge me. Yeah? But now, let's come back to this one. Why is the Lord rebuking Sardis for her imperfection? But you must understand that Sardis is the church of Christ. Hallelujah. That's where the rebuke comes in. Sardis is being rebuked exactly because she is the church. She is the church. Sardis' imperfection is being rebuked because she is the church. Amen? This is the church of Christ. Now, what is it about the church about which her imperfection becomes inappropriate before the Lord? Did I ask that well? What is it about the church that makes it inappropriate before the throne of God to appear imperfect? Did you hear that?
Yeah.
What makes it about the church? What is it about the church, about you and me, that makes it inappropriate before the Lord for us to be imperfect? or what? Incomplete. For our works to be incomplete. Because you see here, he is raising the importance of the deeds that the church is engaging into. Hallelujah. Now we know, of course, we know we have been saved by grace, and we are coming there to answer why is the Lord requiring what? Perfection from the church. Hallelujah. The other day we discussed Genesis chapter 1. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Full stop. And the earth was without form and void, or an empty waste, an empty chasm, or an empty waste. And darkness was upon the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the water. No,
the face of the water.
Over the face of the water, yes. Desolation. And then the Holy Spirit appears. And then God said, let there be light. And there was light. And then begins the process of spiritual renewal. Amen. Then begins this process of spiritual growth. Hallelujah. Then begins this process of separation. So day one, separation. Hallelujah. Let there be light. And then he separated the light from the darkness. Day two, let the water separate from the water, that there may be a space and expanse between the waters above and the waters beneath. Amen? Beneath. Day three, separation. Or is it still day two? Separation. Let the water beneath separate from the land. Let the land come out. Separation. 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 Because be ye holy, for he that has called you is holy. Because the Lord is separate. The word separate is essentially the word for holiness. Amen?
Yeah.
The word for holiness, which means to be separated unto the work of the Lord. But for the Lord now, he is separate. He is other, meaning he is other, otherworldly. No, not meaning worldly. not that God is worldly, no. Otherworldly meaning belonging to another world. Amen? When we say the Lord is holy, he is otherly. Amen? He is not like us. In the sense that we are sinful human beings. He is perfect. He is glorified. He is complete. He needs no super modification. He needs no further growth. He is complete. He is perfect. He is exalted. He is magnified. He has everything he needs. He is sufficient in and of himself. He is the source of all things. He is perfect. He is high. He is lofty. Amen? And therefore, when now he sends his Holy Spirit to come and transform you from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, Paul says, you are seated in heavenly places. He says, when you become a child of God, you are a certain translation takes place. You are translated from this realm into a heavenly realm. That's Colossians chapter 2. Amen? Colossians. Okay, we'll continue next time, yes? But Colossians chapter 2. Well, let's just finish this short segment. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 2. I would like to believe it's somewhere in the first two verses. Hallelujah. It says, seated in heavenly places. Maybe you can help look it up on your small computer there. But I forgot where it is. But the Colossians talks about our being seated in heavenly what? Places. But Colossians chapter 3, okay.
Chapter 3.
Anyways, chapter 3 verse 1 and 2 is close to what I want to say. No? It says, in fact, of course, it's perfectly there. Only that not exactly the one I was quoting. Now, but exactly, this is the separation. Of course, chapter 3 now talks about that separation. Mm-hmm. Now it says, since then you have been raised with Christ. Aha. Uh-huh. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. So now there's this, he says, he translates us from this horizontal living where we are fixed on making money and sleeping around with people we are not married to, where we are too much concerned of what we'll eat today and tomorrow and what kind of brand we wear today, whether I'm wearing Nikes today and Adidas tomorrow, whatever. He takes us from that horizontal living to vertical living where we are fixing our eyes on him. Amen? Mm-hmm. Our spirit is transformed. Our focus is transformed. Amen? Our intentions are transformed. Hallelujah. Our nature is transformed. Therefore, he, if a man is in Christ, he says, all things have passed away. No, he says, if a man is in Christ, yes, all things have passed away. He is a new creature.
Yeah. It's a new creature.
If a man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. New. Holy. That newness is the newness of life in Romans chapter 8, verse 11. It says, for if the Spirit... Romans chapter 8, not verse 11.
What you're looking for is Ephesians 2:6.
Ephesians 2:6. Okay. We'll go to Ephesians 2:6 after Romans. Amen? Hmm. Ephesians 2:6. Romans chapter 8. Okay. Now Ephesians 2:6. Yeah? Ephesians 2:6.
Now.
Did you say 2:6? Praise the Lord. Ephesians 2:6. There it is. Powerful. Exactly this one. Okay. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 says, No. Chapter 6 first. Chapter 6 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin that grace may abound? It says, God forbid! How can we who died to sin live by it any longer? Know you not that as many of us as died... As many of us have been what? Buried with Christ. We're baptized in Christ. We're baptized into his death.
Therefore,
we were buried with him through baptism unto death.
That just as Christ was raised from the dead.
But just as Christ was raised from
the
dead,
by the glory of the Father,
we
also should walk in newness.
Of life. Amen. For all things have become new. Amen. That we have been raised unto newness of life. From horizontal living to vertical living. Hallelujah. This is powerful. Now Romans, was that Romans 6?
Yeah.
Now Romans 8, verse 11, talks about something else also. Before you go there, it says,
but if the Spirit of Him.
But if the Spirit of Him. Continue, please.
But if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you,
He
who raised Christ from the dead will give you life, will also give life unto your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you.
Will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. This is the newness of life now. The life of the Spirit. Amen? A separated life. Genesis chapter 1, separation. Separation. It says, the Holy Spirit will give you new life. This is the separation now. Hallelujah. Raised to newness of life. Hallelujah. It says, dead to horizontal living and alive to vertical living. Amen? And then, now, it says, now when he raised us, then we go to Ephesians 2, what?
6.
Please read it for us.
And raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Jesus Christ.
And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. So really, he has really transformed and translated us in a very radical manner. He says, in the world, but not of the world. Amen? Seated in heavenly places, fixing our eyes on Him. That's the new life. Now, then now in this separatedness, amen? In this separatedness, in this state of separation, He speaks now in the scripture we read earlier, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Amen? 2 Corinthians chapter 7, now that's where now He says, now of course He's already building on another conversation, but this one is the same. Says, 2 Corinthians, yeah? It says, therefore, having these promises,
beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness, the flesh, and spirit, perfecting holiness, the fear of God.
That's the perfection now He's requiring in, what is it?
Sardis.
Sardis. Hallelujah. Says, why is He asking, why is He rebuking Sardis for not being perfect if everyone is imperfect? He says, no. The world is imperfect. The world is wallowing in sin. Not the church. It should not be so with the church. Because as for the church, if you are talking about the church of Christ, we are not talking about some Hindus and Muslims and whatever. We are talking about the church of Christ. Amen? Mm-hmm. The one He paid His precious blood for. He says, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you, that you are not your own. You were bought at a price. Hallelujah. It says, not your own. Raised to newness of life. Separated. Ephesians says, raised to heavenly places. And then Corinthians says, purifying ourselves now. Says, now we are brought in these heavenly places that we have been raised to. We have been called to a life of purity. Amen. Done?
Done.
Let us purify ourselves. The life of purity. Purity in body and spirit. What is contamination? This is the yeast, the sin. This is sin. He's saying, let us purify ourselves from sin. All forms of sin. In Thessalonians, he says, flee from all forms of sin. Not some sins. Amen? Not some. He didn't say, cling to some sins and keep claiming and keep professing that you are still a sinner. No, he says, all appearance of sin, flee from all appearance of sin. He says, purify yourself. And this purity is the purity in body. The purity in spirit. No more dressing like the world. No more living like the world. No more speaking like the world. Yeah. Just makes sense. Newness of life. Newness of life doesn't mean a remodeled old life. No. Newness. If a man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, everything has become new. Everything has become new. Therefore, he says, for you have died to sin, that you may be married to another, Christ Jesus. That you now may walk in purity of body and spirit. He says, a life of purity, 2 Corinthians 7, yeah? He says, a life of perfection in holiness. Perfecting holiness out of reverence of God, the fear of the Lord. There is a lack of the fear of the Lord in church today, you see. Perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Completeness. So now, he says, so now the church is supposed to be holy. The church is supposed to be pure. When you just one more before we read. If you go to Zechariah chapter what? 3. Now you see what the Lord does to the imperfect. Amen? Mm-hmm. What happens if we appear before the Lord with our imperfection? Now we see in Revelation, he rebukes the imperfection. Amen? He says, no, not allowed. Look, he's not rebuking Sardis in heaven. I mean, Sardis did not make it to heaven, and then when she's in heaven, then he rebukes her. No, Sardis is still on earth at this point in time. Sardis is walking here, and he's saying, you have a problem, Sardis. You are not working in the perfect holiness I called you to work in. Walk in. Amen? So he's really rebuking the church on the earth before she enters heaven. So this perfection and holiness is for now, not for when we go to heaven. Don't defend sin. Amen? He says, because you know that the Lord is so holy, in that fear of the Lord, then walk in purity and perfection and holiness. Zechariah chapter 3 says,
Then he showed me Joshua.
Then he showed me Joshua.
The high priest standing before the angel of the Lord and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him.
Uh-huh.
And the Lord said to Satan, The Lord rebuke you, Satan.
The Lord rebuke you, Satan.
The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem to rebuke you.
Hallelujah. Uh-huh.
Is not this man? Oh, is this not a brand plucked from mm-hmm. the fire?
Uh-huh.
Now Joshua was clothed
yes.
with a filthy garment and was standing before the angel.
Uh-huh.
Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying,
uh-huh.
Take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, uh-huh. I have removed your iniquity from you,
uh-huh.
and I will clothe you with rich robes.
Hallelujah.
And I said, let uh-huh. them put a clean
turban on his head. Mm-hmm.
So they put a clean turban on his head and they put clothes on him.
Uh-huh.
And the angel of the Lord stood by.
Hallelujah.
Should I continue?
Uh-huh. The final instruction to the Lord.
Oh, then the angel Lord of the him. Lord admonished Joshua, saying,
uh-huh.
This says the Lord of hosts.
Uh-huh.
If you will walk in my ways,
yes.
and if you will keep my commandments,
yes.
then you shall also judge my house,
uh-huh.
and likewise
yes.
have charge of my courts.
Mm-hmm.
I will give you places to walk among those who stand here.
Among those who stand here, says, if you do what, if what you will walk in obedience ways. And keep my requirements mm-hmm. in the ways of the Lord, mm-hmm. then he will give him a place among. Mm-hmm. We don't have enough time to go deep, yeah. But it says, if you walk in that obedience. The command is to walk in obedience now. Mm-hmm. But which ways are these? Mm-hmm. These are the ways of holiness. These are the ways of purity. Amen? Mm-hmm. This is the way that we are describing here. That when you appear before the Lord, look at this now. Joshua appears, and then immediately Satan appears also. Now what is Satan doing there? Because Joshua had markers that testified of belonging to the devil. That's why Jesus could speak in Romans, in John chapter 8, he says, you are of your father the devil. Because if God were really your father, then you would do the works of God. Yeah, he says, if you are defending sin, and you keep, and you keep defending your imperfection, and say holiness is only for the life after, not for now. It says, now, if you are still testifying that you are walking in sin, then it says this, then your father is the devil. Because if you God were your father, then you will do his works. No, He's not saying 70% must be God's work and then 30% the devil's work. Amen?
Amen?
No, he wants total. Total. Amen?
Amen.
Now, this is to help us understand why he's rebuking Sardis. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. So, he's called the church to perfection. is that 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 15? Ramon is there, and he says, just as he who has called you is holy, be ye holy. Amen. So be holy in all you do. There's the word again. Do. He says, I know your works. I know your deeds. You are dead. He says, your deeds are not perfect before the Lord. And then he says, be holy in all you do, in all your deeds. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. So, it is on this background now, he's speaking to the church in Sardis. That's where the weight is. Sardis, how come you don't know that I'm holy? And you are supposed to be holy. But we understand already that Sardis was deceived. And indeed, if there is a problem we saw throughout all these churches, deception came out paramount. A problem in all these churches that he has been addressing. Perhaps save one. There has been a problem of deception in all these churches. Save one. Huh? And there's been a problem of wrong doctrine. Now, we'll go deeper into Smyrna. But you can see that. So the church is not allowed. It's not allowed to publish imperfection. It says, you are called to publish holiness. He said, look, if someone asks you if you are holy, don't say no. Are you saying you are not? You have never sinned? That's not the first question you should ask. If someone asks you, are you holy? Your first response must not be, are you saying you have never sinned? That's a wrong question to ask back. Then that means you don't know holiness.
That should be the answer.
The answer is, yes or no. If you are not, then you must now take the route to be holy.
Because it's a requirement.
It's a requirement. Yes. Yes, because if you say to the person, look, everyone has already been on the ground. Romans 3:23 is clear. All have sinned. So so the question to say, are you saying you have never sinned? That one really is disqualified. Because it is to imperfect human beings he has come to give his law of holiness. Amen. So when the question comes, if your answer is no, then you know what to do. Then you must be holy. Amen. Then you must take the path that leads to holiness. Yeah. Then that means you are on the wrong path. It's a testimony to one's own to one's own spiritual life. Amen. Yeah. If the answer is no, then you know what to do, because it says, "A highway shall be there." In the book of, I think it's Isaiah 20. As we close, in Isaiah 20, I think it says, "A highway shall be there." He says, these people, they will walk on a certain way. Isaiah what? 20. No, because when you preach holiness, people think you are being self-righteous. But I say, if you think I'm self-righteous for preaching holiness, then you don't know holiness. Because the Bible says, a highway shall be there. Hallelujah. I think it's 20. Can you search for it on your small computer there? Or is it 30? Just search it on your small computer as we read it. Yeah, I mean, and then we read it. Yes. The highway shall be there. As I try to look for it here. 35:8. Amen. A highway shall be there. Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Yes, 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 yes. 35 verse 8 and 9. We read verse 8 and 9. Okay? It says, let me read it. Or do you want to read it? And a highway will be there. King James says, shall be there. It will be called the way of holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Mark the word unclean. Yeah? The unclean sinners. Yeah. This way, in other words, is not for those that walk there are not those that walk in sin. Amen. This is really self-explanatory. The unclean will not journey on it. Because everyone that walks there has already been transformed from darkness to light. Amen. You cannot walk there with your darkness. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there. No devourer. Nor any ravenous beast. They will not be found there. But only the redeemed will walk there. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Last week we watched as the prophet of the Lord shares the vision the Lord shared with him. In this vision, he was walking with the Lord, and then as they were walking, they came to a junction. And then there was a road that goes left, and the road that goes right, the way that goes. I found if you read the Bible, yeah, the Bible will always take you to take the right turn. Isn't it? It says, cast your net on the right side. Amen. Never on the left, no? It says, and the sheep on the right. Amen. So, it says, and the Lord told him to take the right, the way that goes right. Amen. But then he looked on the left, the way that goes left was the way that some people were journeying there. And there were beasts that were devouring them in that vision, that mighty vision. And so he continued walking with the Lord. And as they continued walking, he said, this road was winding, 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 winding. And then it came to a point where it went right. And then it went right again. And then it went even more right. Until they came to a place where he saw the building. And as they saw this building, and then the Lord said to him, look, this